evening and welcome. Tonight I'm going to be reading to you from some history magazines. So there's a little bit of backstory for the magazines now, because the articles from now on are going to be picked by my channel members. So if you are a member and haven't picked an article yet, check out the members only videos. There's a video there that lists all the articles to choose from. Pick as many as you like. And if you want to be a part of that, the join button's right down there. It's only 99 cents a month. And you can have a more active role on the channel. So I was planning to read from this magazine tonight, because three articles out of this magazine were picked. It was these three specifically. But here's the thing. If you haven't seen my videos from this week, it is so boiling hot in here. I'm like literally drenched in sweat at the end of my videos, and I've been sticking to the book, and my phone's overheating. So I really didn't want to do three articles on a night where it's super hot. So I figured I would do the article that was most requested, this one about Ulysses S. Grant before he was president and when he was a general in the Civil War. But I also did a poll so that everyone could pick one of the mini articles, and it's from this magazine. So we're going to do that first, and then we're going to go to General Grant. And I would like to give a shout out to Jacob Miller and Lynn Mendoza, my channel members who picked General Grant to hear about. But let's read the article that you guys picked. You guys, out of the main ones, if I can turn the page, there we go. You wanted to hear about Samuel Morse, which this article is mostly about the invention itself, not so much about the man behind it, but still very interesting. There he is. So, Morse code, communication goes electric. Long distance communication had been talked about for centuries before Samuel Morse. English astronomer Robert Hooke was the first to describe visual telegraphy in a speech to the Royal Society in 1684, referring to it as a method of discoursing at distance, not by sound, but by sight. He was talking about semaphore, a messaging system that was finally developed in 1794 thanks to the French engineer Claude Chappe. Amid the turmoil of the French Revolution, with enemy forces advancing on its borders, the French government desperately needed a fast and reliable communication system for its army. Chappe's semaphore consisted of movable wooden arms, a horizontal beam, and two vertical arms that could be moved into nearly 200 standard positions, each within assigned meaning. From hilltop stations positioned as far as 20 miles apart, messages were read by telescope, then forwarded. Using a network of 556 semaphores, communications could flow from Paris to the far corners of the country in 3 or 4 hours, much faster than the several days it would take on horseback. It was the first important step in the history of long-distance communication. Dots and dashes. Visual telegraphy was replaced by electronic telegraphy thanks to two scientific developments. Italian physicist Alessandro Volta's invention of the battery in 1800 allowed for reliable storage of electricity. The phenomenon of electromagnetism was discovered by Danish scientist Hans Christian Ørsted in 1820, when he observed how an electric current running through a wire could move a compass needle. In the 1830s, two teams of researchers incorporated both of those advances in their pursuit of the electric telegraph. In England, Sir William Cook and Sir Charles Wheatstone started with a system of 5 magnetic needles requiring 5 separate wires. Using an electric current, the needles could be pointed around a panel of letters and numbers to spell out messages. In the United States, painter-turned-inventor Samuel Morse, working with Leonard Gale and Alfred Vail, took a much simpler approach. Morse's idea was to use a single wire to pass electric current through an electromagnet to trigger a pencil on a receiver that would record marks on paper. To render such markings useful, Morse devised a code. Originally, it consisted of numbers corresponding to words in an English dictionary, but this cumbersome method didn't work for proper names of people and places. Morse and Vail worked out an easier way to code the transmitted messages. Instead of groups of numerals representing words, they decided to use combinations of symbols made of dots and dashes to represent letters and numbers. The most common characters were assigned the simplest combinations. For example, the letter E is represented by a single dot, and T is one dash. In 1848, German Friedrich Clemens Gerke would revise Morse's version, creating what became known as International Morse Code. It would eventually replace Morse's American version. By mutual agreement, Morse's name ended up on all the patents. Vail, who received a financial stake, played an important, if not primary, role in revising the original code. He also created an improved telegraph key in which brief touches produced a dot, while longer ones yielded dashes. For his part, Gale added a transmitting relay to extend the range of the telegraph signal. In 1843, Morse received $30,000 from the U.S. Congress to demonstrate the electric telegraph. The team set up a 40-mile telegraph line between Washington, D.C. and Baltimore, Maryland. On May 24, 1844, Morse and his team transmitted the first telegraph message, quoting the biblical book of Numbers, "What hath God wrought?" What took hours to communicate by semaphore would now take minutes by telegraph. The telegraph itself began to spread quickly. Within a decade, more than 23,000 miles of telegraph cable crisscrossed the United States. In 1856, Western Union began sending telegrams across America that arrived in less than a day. In 1858, the first transatlantic cable was laid, stretching from Newfoundland, Canada, to Ireland. The electronic information age had officially begun. Good choice. All right, on to the main event. Let's learn about Ulysses Simpson Grant. Did anyone else grow up on Animaniacs and knows Ulysses Simpson Grant, who would scream and rage and rant while drinking whiskey, although risky, though he spilled it on his pants? Does anyone else know that song? Anyway, oh dear. I cannot turn the page. Some pirates. Alright, Grant ascended. And there he is, looking pretty dapper. Does it say where this was taken? Let's see. Cold Harbor, Virginia. In 1864. When the U.S. Civil War began the morning of April 12, 1861, no one could have identified Ulysses S. Grant as the man who would lead the Union Army to victory. A former Army officer, Grant had left the military in 1854. He and his family lived in Missouri before relocating to Galena, Illinois in 1860. When war broke out, Grant was working as a clerk in his father's leather store. Galena, I hope that's how you say that. Galena was a small farming town in 1861, and it took 6 days after the attack on Fort Sumter for news of the war to reach it. The citizens were galvanized to fight against secession, and a town meeting was held to rally to the cause. Grant led the proceedings, where, after several rousing speeches by representatives of different political parties, the unified people volunteered to form a company of soldiers. Grant organized and drilled these recruits before accompanying them to Springfield, the state capital. After they arrived, the governor was so impressed that he made Grant his military aide, in charge of incorporating the disparate companies of the Illinois militia. By June, Grant was a colonel in command of the 21st Illinois Volunteer Infantry. He was on his way to the battles that would lead him to victory and greatness. Background. Born April 27, 1822, in Point Pleasant, Ohio, Hiram Ulysses Grant was the eldest of Jesse and Hannah Grant's five children. In 1823, the Grant family moved to Georgetown, Ohio, where young Ulysses would grow up. His father was a tanner, a profession in which Ulysses had no interest. In his memoirs, Grant wrote, "I detested the trade, but I was fond of agriculture and of all employment in which horses were used." He began schooling at age 5 and continued through his teens when he was surprised to learn that his father had secured him an appointment to the U.S. Military Academy in West Point, New York. Grant began his studies at West Point in 1839. He was a somewhat mediocre student with an excellent reputation for his equestrian skills. He studied next to many men whom he would later fight alongside and against. Before graduating in 1843, he would encounter more than 50 future Civil War generals, an experience that would serve him well in the war to come. Appointed a Brevet Second Lieutenant, I don't know that word, Grant's first assignment was the 4th Infantry Regiment stationed at Jefferson Barracks near St. Louis, Missouri. There he fell in love with Julia Dent, the sister of his West Point roommate, and was engaged to her before being called up to fight in the Mexican War, serving in many major battles and twice being breveted for bravery. I guess that's I don't know. After the war, Grant returned to Missouri and married Julia in 1848. He resigned from the U.S. Army as a captain in 1854, first settling in Missouri, and then relocating in 1860 to Galena, Illinois. Battles on the River. After fighting broke out at Fort Sumter on April 12, 1861, Grant knew which side he was on. In a letter to his father, Jesse, in April 1861, he wrote, "There are but two parties now, traitors and patriots, and I want hereafter to be ranked with the latter." After organizing the Illinois Volunteers and receiving a quick promotion, Colonel Grant's 21st Regiment was transferred to Missouri in July 1861, where more regiments fell under Grant's command, earning him another promotion, this time to Brigadier General. Grant's skills attracted the attention of the Union commander of the Department of the West, Major General John C. Fremont, who tapped Grant to plan a campaign down the Mississippi River, perhaps the most vital transportation artery in the United States at the time, and key to weakening the Confederacy. Setbacks occurred when President Lincoln removed Fremont from command after he had announced an intention to free enslaved people belonging to traitors. Lincoln was not ready to antagonize enslavers in contested border states like Missouri and Kentucky, but Fremont's parting gift to the Union was his selection of Brigadier General Ulysses Grant to command the troops at Cairo, Illinois. On November 7th, Grant steamed down the Mississippi with 3,000 men and seized a Confederate outpost at Belmont, Missouri, across from heavily fortified Columbus, Kentucky, where rebel batteries brooded over the river. His troops, raw recruits from Illinois and Iowa, celebrated wildly, which enabled Confederate Major General Leonidas Polk to ferry reinforcements across the river and block Grant's escape route. Euphoria gave way to panic when Polk bombarded Grant's forces. Some Union officers wanted to surrender, but Grant would have none of it. "We cut our way in and can cut our way out," he said. By extricating his forces from Belmont, Grant earned a reputation as one who would never give up. In late January 1862, Grant left the Mississippi and advanced southward to the Tennessee River with 17,000 men in steamboats, shielded by ironclad gunboats, commanded by Flag Officer Andrew Foote. The first ironclads to enter battle during the war, they opened fire on February 6th at Fort Henry, a low-lying, flood-swept Confederate bastion whose gunners were pounded into submission before troops Grant sent ashore reached the fort. That victory helped clear the way for him to follow the Tennessee River deep into enemy territory. But before that could happen, he first had to deal with Fort Donelson, situated nearby on the Cumberland River and crucial to the defense of Tennessee's capital, Nashville. Set on high ground and heavily defended, Fort Donelson withstood attack by Foote's ironclads, but was hemmed in by Grant's troops under Brigadier Generals John C. Clernand, Charles F. Smith, and Lew Wallace. The three Confederate generals who shared command of the fort, John Floyd, Gideon Pillow, and Simon Buckner, tried to break out on February 15th, but Grant repelled their forces. That night, Floyd and Pillow fled by boat, leaving 13,000 men behind under Buckner, who sought a truce. Buckner was a friend of Grant's at West Point and perhaps expected a gentler answer than the one he received. "No terms except an unconditional and immediate surrender can be accepted," Grant replied, and Buckner yielded. Grant's past experiences at West Point and in the Mexican War gave the Union an edge. He knew many of the men he was fighting against and used that knowledge to his advantage. In his memoirs, Grant wrote, "I had known General Pillow in Mexico and judged that with any force, no matter how small, I could march up to within gunshot of any entrenchments he was given to hold. I knew that Floyd was in command, but he was no soldier." Simon Buckner was a year behind Grant at West Point, and the two had been friends there. When Buckner came to discuss the terms of surrender, Grant later recalled, "Buckner told me that if he had been in command, I would not have got up to Donelson as easily as I could. I told him that if he had been in command, I should not have tried in the way that I did." News of Grant's victory, which led to the capture of Nashville, made him a national hero. His initials, U.S., came to signify unconditional surrender and the determination of Uncle Sam to crush the rebellion. Grant's success at these two battles would establish his bona fides as a leader to be reckoned with. Bloodbath at Shiloh. After capturing Fort Donelson and advancing to the rank of Major General, Grant resumed his advance up the Tennessee in March and disembarked at Pittsburgh Landing on the river's west bank, just above the Tennessee-Mississippi border. His objective was Corinth, Mississippi, a vital rail junction some 20 miles away. It was held by General Albert Sidney Johnston, the opposing commander in the west and one of the highest-ranking Confederate officers. Grant assumed that Johnston would remain on the defensive and planned to assault Corinth once Union reinforcements arrived under Major General Don Carlos Buell, who had taken Nashville. Grant's trusted subordinate, Brigadier General William Sherman, set up camp near a little church called Shiloh. Like Grant, Sherman did not fear assault, and he did not order his men to entrench. Meanwhile, 40,000 Confederates led by Johnston advanced undetected from Corinth to within a few miles of Sherman's position at Shiloh. At dawn on Sunday, April 6th, Johnston sent Major General William Hardee's corps slamming into Grant's startled forces. "My God, we are attacked," cried General Sherman. Many of his men were still in their tents. They fell back along with the exposed forces of Brigadier General Benjamin Prentiss as two more Confederate corps under Major Generals Braxton Bragg and Leonidas Polk entered battle. The swarming Confederates soon lost cohesion, however, allowing their foes to regroup. By midday, the Federals had established a new battle line near a sunken road and field called the Hornet's Nest for the furious fighting there. Around 2 that afternoon... Shiloh Meeting House, we'll look at that in a minute. Johnston rode forward to rally his troops and was hit by a bullet that severed an artery and later that day took his life. His successor, Brigadier General P.G.T. Beauregard, the most southern name of all time, continued to throw Confederate forces into the deadly Hornet's Nest. Union forces held out long enough for Grant to prepare a last line of defense near the river. Major General Lew Wallace ended up on the wrong road and arrived belatedly, but Sherman stood fast on Grant's right flank, while Union gunboats on the river blasted the oncoming Confederates. With daylight waning, Beauregard concluded that his victory was sufficiently complete and postponed further attacks, expecting that Grant would retreat across the Tennessee that evening. Grant, however, believed that the Union could turn things around. He later recalled, "So confident I was before firing had ceased on the 6th that the next day would bring victory to our arms if we could only take the initiative, that I visited each division commander in person before any reinforcements had reached the field." Fortunately, Union forces were reinforced by Buell, newly arrived from Nashville, who ferried thousands of men across the river overnight. Early on April 7th, Grant counterattacked with his fresh troops and pushed the Confederates back. "This day," wrote Grant, "everything was favorable to the Union side. We had now become the attacking party. The enemy was driven back all day." In mid-afternoon, Beauregard cut his losses and withdrew to Corinth, shielded by his rear guard near Colonel Nathan Bedford Forrest, whose cavalry repulsed pursuing Federals the following day at Fallen Timbers. Grant had held his ground at Shiloh, a technical victory overshadowed by the appalling human cost. More than 13,000 Union casualties and nearly 11,000 Confederate losses. It was by far the bloodiest battle yet fought on Is that a typo or just a weird sentence? The bloodiest battle yet fought on since the nation was founded. Okay. Anyway, Beauregard's fine reputation in the South was spoiled, and Grant faced a storm of criticism for letting down his guard. Some called for his dismissal, but Lincoln offered him a memorable endorsement. "I can't spare this man. He fights." The Vicksburg Campaign. In the months following Shiloh, Union commanders debated their next moves. They succeeded in taking Corinth, Mississippi by May 30, 1862. Because of the controversy surrounding Shiloh, Grant was briefly sidelined. He was reinstated in July as the commander of the Army of the Tennessee by the senior Union Army commander in the Western Theater, Major General Henry Halleck. Union forces began to then turn their attention to new Confederate targets along the Mississippi River. Many agreed that the obvious choice was Vicksburg. Known as the Gibraltar of the Confederacy, Vicksburg was perched on bluffs high above the Mississippi, shielded by big guns that deterred assault by river and swampy surroundings that discouraged attack by land. Yet Grant was determined to take that rebel stronghold on the river's east bank, come hell or high water, and gratify President Lincoln, who had stood by him after Shiloh. One of the few things Abraham Lincoln and Jefferson Davis agreed upon was the strategic significance of Vicksburg. It was the vital artery through which the Confederacy received shipments from Louisiana, Arkansas, and Texas, including European weapons imported through Mexico to avoid the federal blockade. Vicksburg was the nailhead that held the South's two halves together, Davis said. The city's batteries also divided the Union by preventing its forces from moving freely between federal-occupied New Orleans and Memphis, and its western farmers from shipping produce downriver to distant markets. "Vicksburg is the key," Lincoln said. "The war can never be brought to a close until that key is in our pocket." In late January 1863, Grant moved his headquarters from Memphis to Young's Point, Louisiana, upriver from Vicksburg, and conducted experiments aimed at circumnavigating its defenses. Attempts failed to find a way through bayous north of town that would allow Grant to approach Vicksburg from the east, where the ground was firmer and the city was vulnerable. So he planned instead to march south, well west of the city's batteries, while gunboats led by Admiral David Dixon Porter ran that gauntlet. Aided by Porter's fleet, Union forces would then cross the Mississippi and move inland, sweeping around to the east of Vicksburg like a snake encircling its prey. By leaving the river, which served as his supply line and avenue of retreat, Grant risked being cut off. Sherman urged him to abandon the plan, arguing that when any great body of troops moved against an enemy, they should do so from a base of supplies and never lose touch with that base. Grant thanked him for his friendly advice, but pressed ahead. He left Sherman's corps north of town temporarily to preoccupy Vicksburg's defenders by staging diversions at Haynes Bluff and Snyder's Bluff. If all went as planned, Sherman's corps would later form the tail of the snake as Grant attacked the city. On the night of April 16th, Porter's ironclad steamed downriver past Vicksburg and engaged in a thunderous duel with rebel gunners on the bluffs. "Our batteries were in full play," observed a Confederate officer, blazing away at the line of gunboats. Porter's fleet emerged largely unscathed, only to face an even stiffer test at Grand Gulf, where where Grant planned to cross to the east bank. Confederate artillery there fought fiercely with the gunboats for 5 hours on April 29th, inducing Grant to bypass Grand Gulf and march farther south to Bruinsburg, where his troops crossed safely on the 30th. Sherman, meanwhile, was doing his part by assailing Confederates under Major General Carter Stevenson north of Vicksburg. Stevenson wrote Lieutenant General John Pemberton, the commander of Vicksburg, that this was the real attack and that Federal moves below Vicksburg must be a feint. "Send me reinforcements," he pleaded. Pemberton then recalled forces he had sent south, which served Grant's purpose. After defeating Brigadier General John Bowen's outnumbered Confederates at Port Gibson on May 1st, Grant took Raymond on May 12th and entered Mississippi's capital, Jackson, 2 days later. His swift advance prevented General Joseph Johnston, back in action after being wounded at Seven Pines a year earlier, from reaching Vicksburg by way of Jackson and reinforcing Pemberton. Grant made things worse for Vicksburg's defenders by cutting the railroad from Jackson that supplied them, while his own troops lived off the land by seizing crops and cattle from the populace. Vicksburg besieged. Belatedly, Pemberton came out from Vicksburg to challenge Grant at Champion Hill on May 16th. Major General James McPherson's corps helped Grant repulse Pemberton, who retreated to Vicksburg across the Big Black River and burned the bridge behind him. Federal engineers soon spanned the river with pontoons, and Grant launched two determined but unsuccessful attacks on Vicksburg's defenses on May 19th and 22nd, before laying siege to the city. "This is a death struggle," wrote Sherman, who had rejoined Grant, "and will be terrible." Federal gunners bombarded Vicksburg, driving civilians into hastily dug caves. Cut off by land and by water, where Porter's fleet held sway, hungry troops and inhabitants fed on horses, dogs, and rats. As the federal noose tightened and sickness and famine spread, a Confederate soldier sent Pemberton a pointed message: "If you can't feed us, you had better surrender us, horrible as the idea is, than suffer this noble army to disgrace themselves by desertion." When Pemberton sought terms on July 3rd, Grant first insisted on unconditional surrender, but then agreed to release Vicksburg's defenders on parole, which required them to pledge not to take up arms again. Before dawn on July 4th, Pemberton surrendered the city and its forces. Grant's triumph at Vicksburg and Lee's simultaneous defeat at Gettysburg made this America's most fateful Independence Day since 1776. After Vicksburg, Grant and his team secured another important victory for the Union after taking Chattanooga in autumn 1863, adding another success to his track record, which Union leadership could not ignore. The war in the West brought out the best in Grant, nurturing his talents and allowing them to grow, while the war in the East had been nothing but challenging for the Union. Defeats and failed campaigns plagued President Lincoln, who found himself firing one general after another. Lincoln saw the nation's solution in Grant, and the nation agreed. In early 1864, Lieutenant General Ulysses S. Grant became the second American after George Washington to rise through the ranks and earn his honor without brevet. I still don't know what that means. Someone will tell me in the comments for sure. Grant then took command of all the armies of the United States and began planning the campaigns that would defeat the Confederacy. When Grant received Lincoln's commission, he humbly replied, "With the aid of the noble armies that have fought in so many fields for our common country, it will be my earnest endeavor not to disappoint your expectations. I feel the full weight of the responsibilities now devolving on me, and I know that if they are met, it will be due to those armies, and above all, to the favor of the Providence which leads both nations and men." My, he had a way with words. Grant's road to victory would not be easy, but his tenacity, tactics, and faith in his men, from his generals to his foot soldiers, would help defeat the Confederacy and unite the nation. Let's look at the pictures real quick, because there are some cool ones in here. Let's see, so the first one here we looked at, this photograph, there's the Union flag. We've got, let's see what this is. I don't see the, oh, this is West Point, apparently back in the day. A cadet's coat, West Point, and a young Ulysses S. Grant. Let's see. 1843 graduation photo. Here's a big old gunboat that we heard a lot about. Battles of Fort Henry and Fort Donelson, which, you know, I'm sure that my battles book will have at least Shiloh and Gettysburg in them. So we'll look at some battles then. This is Andrew Foote. We've got a fort here. This is Fort Donelson. Let's see, this is the unconditional surrender letter that Grant sent. And here's William Tecumseh Sherman, very notorious Union general there. The Shiloh Meeting House. Apparently this is a replica. I wonder what happened to the original one. Anyway, this is where Grant was camped during the battle. There you go, now you can see it. We've got, let's see, this is Grant on the left, that must be him, personally commanding Union forces at Shiloh. A Minié ball, a type of ammunition. We've got a big old map here of Shiloh. Anyway, my phone's overheating now, so let me wrap this up. We've got a monument to the 96th Ohio Infantry Regiment. For the Ohio soldiers who fought in Vicksburg. There's the big battle right there. And let's see. It doesn't say what this is from, it's just a soldier, but it talks about the loss of life there. The victory medal that Grant got for Vicksburg. And here is a statue. Let's see, where is this? In Washington, D.C., facing the Lincoln Memorial. How appropriate. All right, so, phone's about to, it's yelling at me, so let me wrap this up. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you found this video relaxing and educational, and I hope that you have a